drop his disk drive, explode the room.
That's for the laser.
My kid in the second half. Instead of trying to embarrass her once.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I think I am streaming live on the internet. Yes. Okay. Welcome to Governor's Island. Welcome to Graphic Design, now in production, exhibition organized by cooper-hewitt National Design Museum here on Governor's Island. We have a great event for you here today. Designers from Spain and around the world to talk about graphic design and how they work and the nature of design today. So anyway, a round of applause for our special guests. cooper-hewitt is the nation's only museum dedicated exclusively to graphic design. Our permanent home is on the Upper East Side here in New York. And this summer, we are doing this great exhibition here on Governor's Island as we are closed for renovations. And today's event is a collaboration with another arm of the Smithsonian, the Hirshhorn Museum and Sculpture Garden in Washington, D.C. So it's a great event for our two museums, which are part of the nation's network of national museums, to do something together and to celebrate design and to celebrate our relationship with the Spanish Embassy, who we love to collaborate with. So the event is part of the Spain Artists and Arts and Culture Program, and it's celebrating the launching of the book We Made This ES, about post-digital creation in Spain. And our format's very simple. Our designers will talk briefly about their work, and then we'll have a conversation between myself and Hector Eichter of OFFF, and is the author of the book, and a great designer and friend of designers, and so we'll have a conversation with our guests and with you, the audience. So before we do that, I'm going to introduce Guillermo Corral, who is the cultural attaché from the Embassy of Spain, and he's going to say a few words about the program.
Thank you. Thank you, Ellen, and thanks, everybody, for being here, especially in a sunny and nice day like today, and taking the ferry and coming so far just to be with us. So I'll be very brief. I just wanted to share with you a couple of ideas about or information about how this project came to life, to contextualize it a little bit. Visual arts have always been huge in Spain. I mean, traditionally and still nowadays, visual is probably the key element in Spanish culture. It has been like this for centuries, and it's still like this nowadays, although probably the preeminence of painting has translated into movies and design and new fields. When we launched the Spain Arts and Culture brand a couple of years ago, I mean, these little catalogs that you have on your chairs are our semestral catalog. We wanted from the beginning to use design to project the image we wanted to accomplish. I mean, we knew there was a lot of young people doing things, but and we wanted them to be a part of it from the beginning. So we start having one illustrator in each issue, and you know, looking at the whole scene. And what we discovered, in fact, was that there was a new generation with a number of common traits. They were all very young, they were pretty successful, they were still living in Spain, but working globally. And well, we thought that, I mean, that would require a more in-depth look. So we contacted Hector, that has a tremendous experience in working with all sorts of digital or post-digital design, as he likes to call it. We discussed a number of possible ideas, and we ended up with this book, this great book that we're launching today. You can find it downstairs at the museum store. And in parallel with the book that reunites for the first time this whole new generation of young Spanish designers, we will be hosting a number of events across the country. We are launching the project in collaboration with, of course, the cooper-hewitt. Thanks, Ellen. We're very impressed with your support and understanding of the project. And of course, with the Hitchhorn Museum. Thank you, Jessica, as well, who came here to be with us today. And we'll have another event in Washington this week. So, I mean, this is a great day for us. Very, very interesting. We think this book raises a number of questions, not only referring to Spanish design, but to design in general. Is there still a thing like national designs? Or are these guys doing anything different than American designers do? Is all the same part of the same global visual culture? I mean, how does this interaction between local and global works in design? Is this art, or is it just design? I mean, all these questions that you know, but are still relevant, important, and illustrated by a general book such as this. To open the presentation, Hector has prepared for us all the fantastic video. And he had an idea I found is pretty interesting. He asked the designers that are featured in the book to select a few the favorite movies from recent Spanish cinema. So this is a visual art commenting on another one. So image to image. I think it's the result looks pretty amazing, at least to me, and I hope you'll enjoy it. Thank you.
La gente sigue la corriente y tiene de más. Si yo pudiera algún día remontarme a las estrellas, conmigo te llevaría a donde nadie nos viera. No hagas caso de la gente, sigue la corriente y quiere de más. Que si esto es escandaloso, es más vergonzoso no saber
New York to Saigon, Vietnam, mutila de David.
Vuelva en sí, continencia.
Atención, aquí os presento al comandante Torres.
Wow, that was really fantastic. Thank you, Hector. So I'm going to introduce our first speaker, Rodrigo Corral, who's an amazing graphic designer working here in New York City. It's Farrar, Straus, and Giroux, which is one of the world's most esteemed publishing houses. He also has, at the same time, his own independent business. He has produced legendary book covers for books that many of you have read, including James Frey's Million Little Pieces and the many, many novels of Chuck Palahniuk, some of which are on view downstairs in the exhibition. So I'm really excited to finally get to meet him and to hear him speak in person. So welcome, Rodrigo.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Can you hear me with this mic? Just want to make sure. Welcome. They say never to alienate your crowd. I say this half joking, half serious, that you all must love design and listening and wanting to be a part of design on such a beautiful day and being inside, which I think you're a little crazy for that. Because I would rather be outside right now instead of doing this. So I took very literally the talking about process, the idea of talking about design as process. And I find myself incredibly stuck trying to think about process today. And I started in design. And being in book publishing design, it is a very it's a very isolating way to work. You have a manuscript you have to read, and you have a very small group of people to satisfy. The author first, second the publisher, and third, it's supposed to be the marketing director, but it's really the spouse or partner of the author is really the person. That's the unspoken thing. So this is the first illustration I chose to try to explain how the process began. I have a manuscript. I'm not entirely sure what tools to use besides the obvious computer. And it's just blank, and you're trying to find a solution of what it should be. I looked to packaging the wrong places. I looked at the idealized packaging of toothpaste and soap packaging. I really looked everywhere to try. When you're starting, you are looking for confirmation, right? You want to understand or have someone say, yes, that's good. And since you are working on your own as a book jacket designer, I didn't have a lot of people necessarily to bounce ideas off of. So most of my early energy was spent what I would call spinning. And it really was my staring at the screen and feeling like I'm looking at something very empty. Probably one of the first rules I made for myself as a designer was, and I actually just named it this rule yesterday. It's called the George Washington rule, but it's a rule that I've had, and that is make sure to choose to succeed at the projects you want to succeed at. The reason why it's George Washington, one of the first covers I had to work on was a book, a biography of Abraham Lincoln, and I quickly realized that in the process, what am I going to do? I'm going to pick an image of Abraham, an etching, a painting, and then I'm going to put some type on it. And then I realized that that's not, ultimately didn't fulfill me very much to work that way. So I put a beard on George Washington and sent those sketches to the design, to the art director. He had a sense of humor about it and understood that, okay, you're not going to put George Washington on the cover. But the point was, is I wanted to find a way to express things for the authors where there was a lot more room for translation. In a biography, there isn't as much room. So sending this sketch over pretty much ended my working relationship with this one client, which was a form of creative suicide. But I knew that I was confident about wanting to have a collaboration with authors where I was asked to actually translate something, and I didn't see that there was much to translate here. Be careful what you wish for. I started probably after 5 years of staring at screens, staying late at work, and thinking that hard work really gets you where you want to be. I finally started to actually try to actually trust my instincts as to what an author is trying to say. And that probably became the thing that I focused on most, is trying to read through manuscripts and understand what is the author's message, what is the purpose here, and what was he thinking in the process? Why that title? And through this process and getting something approved, you start to develop this sort of what I would call a combination of false confidence in a way, because it's gone through the process of a marketing meeting and authors and, like I said, their partners. And you start to just show ideas of what you think a book's about. In this case, it's a book about you read a lullaby to a child and that child dies. Now, I'm not going to put a dead baby on a book because no one's going to buy a book that looks like that. So you try to find metaphors, and fortunately, sometimes they work. This author in particular has been very, very indulgent in allowing me to just pursue what I think is best. Where I thought I would want complete isolation, it sometimes can become very frightening, because all the books I've done with Chuck, all I get is a note that says, good luck, look forward to what you do, seeing what you come up with. And oftentimes, it probably takes 5 to 10 solutions to get there. But there is no big master plan laid out for you, what they're looking for. It's usually stripped down to the thing I hear most, please make it iconic, please make it powerful. And that can mean anything to anybody. How do you translate germs and spreading germs without making someone feel repulsed? How do you put your first initial on a cover and use the title as rant being the title, but for yourself, in this case, I play that game where, I tell myself that I'm putting my first initial on the cover, but in the end, if you take the jacket off, it just says the title. How do you tell a story about someone trying to break the world's record in pornography and sleeping with the most people at one time? That's how. Anyhow, so through this process, where I realized in putting this presentation together, there is such minimal conversation taking place. It's a manuscript, it's you, and then the tools you choose to work with. In the business of translating these stories, I have worked on some nonfiction work. And it's usually for the New York Times, and it's translating an op-ed piece. But what I end up getting really interested about the New York Times is these images that are very painful and very real. And I try to find a way where I can adapt the feeling that you get when you see this, but for novels. So there's again this game of trying to interpret and translate something that can suggest pain. And not necessarily show where it becomes too real and off-putting. That blank space that I used to have is now surrounded by tons of information that I surround myself with. Being these stills is one example that I regularly am cutting out images from the New York Times. And I think that's, if I had to strip down what my process is as a designer and as a creative person, is I just cut out something that I like or screen grab, or if it's a song, I'll write down the word, few words from it, and I'm not necessarily trying to question what the idea, why I like it. It's more of, I like this image, I will attach an idea to it at some point. So a lot of this archive exists in actual books, but for the most part, it's in my head. An example of trying to translate violence, this book had a ton of violence in it, gruesome violence, and I usually find violence, I actually laugh a lot at violence, but in this book, I found myself feeling very uncomfortable. So how do you translate in a way where it's not, again, repulsive? How do you translate drug addiction and obsessive compulsive behavior, including lying? How do you translate technology and how we can compartmentalize feelings? So I don't know if these are actual accurate solutions or if anyone gets those feelings from these projects, but that's what I try to do. In the process of doing this talk, I felt like I should come out of the closet and let everyone know that I still am probably the last remaining person who uses Quark Express. Some people said I should not admit this, but I should finally talk about it. With each intern that comes through my studio in my office, the look of horror is turned to disgust and embarrassment and shame and even, come on, just let me give you a tutorial in InDesign. It's okay, you're gonna have to get used to it anyway. I still am resisting it. I was told when I started a year ago at Farrar Straus by the IT department, I was brought into a room and they said, you know, just so you know, we're gonna give you 1 year and 1 year only, and after that year, we're gonna put you on InDesign. So, with that being said, I can't design or illustrate in Quark Express. So I now have to surround myself with people that can actually execute these ideas on my behalf. So my business now is very much of ideas and ownership of ideas. I don't know if I necessarily felt comfortable in talking about that 5 years ago, but I do now and feel that that's really where my focus is. I wanted to find a quote, but it's the idea of ownership. Of owning ideas is really what I really believe in. So all these things are collaborations now where I pretty much just sketch with a Sharpie and hand it to someone and say, please, can you make this? And I can still actually design in Quark Express, as you can see. This is my really super top flight skills in Quark. This project, it's one example where it happens probably 3 or 4 times a year. And it's when you get a project that you feel like someone's tapped into your email or someone's following you and knows what's going on in your life personally. And I got this project probably 3 months after my relationship with my girlfriend had ended. And reading this story, the title story, it was absolutely heartbreaking. And it's one of these things where it's sort of refreshing and very feeds my paranoia in thinking that this person knew, this art director that assigned me this must know I'm going through something right now. So it ends up becoming, like I said, this very funny dual situation. So it ends up becoming an opportunity to translate my own experiences, and I feel like I try to do that in most projects. This one just happens to be like the eye of the storm, and that is the solution is you play with someone's heart, and this is what happens, you lose her. So all that work has been pretty much a process of working by yourself and really just asking people to execute things, and then you send it off to an author, publisher, and all you look for is yes, no, try again, or that's actually all I want to hear. I don't want to hear any other words of, you know, try this a little bit more. I'd rather just say you like it or you don't. I will go back if you're not pleased with it. This working with, this has become a very different project where it became a collaboration with someone who's bigger than life. Working with Jay-Z, it's a celebrity. It's someone who has already a built-in identity where most authors that I'm collaborating with are not necessarily household names. So this is very much a very strange experience. I enjoyed it, but I don't necessarily know if I'm up for this challenge again, because I tried to apply for what I do in covers to an interior of a book, which is try to make each spread its own piece of art. And that's very exhausting. It probably took about 8 months of my life and was probably fired and hired 3 times on this project. So it was very, very exhausting. So something that I don't think I will ever try again. So this is where I am now. I'm crumpling paper. And that's because I am probably going a little mad. And it's probably also because I am so comfortable in reaching for so many different sources of inspiration, whether it's tearing something out of a newspaper or a conversation, or if it's playing Brick Breaker on the subway and not trying to focus on what I should be focusing on. This is what I'm doing now. So if anybody has a therapist that they could recommend for me, an art therapist I would prefer, please help me, because this is where I am now. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Hector Ayuso. So, thank you everybody for coming. We are here with Brosmine and Marta Cerdà. They came from Barcelona, and they will introduce themselves much better than I'll do it. So I just want to say thank you to Ellen and Cooper Hewitt, Jessica and Hisrom, and especially Spanish Embassy in Washington, Guillermo, Curro, and Xavier, for making this happen and bring this such talent artist from Barcelona. So just enjoy them, and thank you, guys.
Hello. I may introduce myself first, because... What? Okay. I'm going to introduce a little bit myself first, because you may not know me. I am Marta Cerdà, and I come from a little town next to Barcelona, which is called Vilafranca. This is the typical thing in my town. They do human towers, and nearly all the villages involved in these things since the 18th century, so it's super typical. And now they go all over the world and they do super high constructions. They are going to come to New York on the 21st in Union Square. So if you want to go, I totally recommend that. So anyway, that's not important. Important is my work. Okay, I work alone, but since 2008. But I share a studio with Turmix, which are also in the book. I think most of the people that are in the book, we know each other in some way, you know? I'm a graphic designer, but I'm mainly focused in illustration and typography. And my clients are agencies, are editorials, and myself. I do a lot of self-projects too. So here in my little room, you can see that I work with this Wacom, which is kind of weird because it gives you the illusion that you're working on a manual, on a paper, but you're working on a document, so everything is digital. So I can say that thanks to technology, I can keep my process manual, but it's much faster. And also thanks to technology, thanks to internet, I can have most of my clients abroad. This now is really important because in Spain, you know that we are going through a big crisis. So internet is giving us the opportunity to show us to the world. We don't have to go door by door, showing your work, telling who you are, so it's easier. So when did it all start? I started studying psychology, and I found myself hooked at everything that had to do with perception and illusions. So because in the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, the psychologists were the ones that were most intrigued by this kind of images, and I thought, okay, maybe I should quit psychology and start graphic design. And when I quit it, I thought, wow, this has been a waste of time, 2 years doing this. I don't know if I'm going to use this anytime, but I think that, it's kind of my background, this. For example, I'm going to show just very quickly a project. Yeah, I think that more in the 20th century, the artists are getting more and more interested by this kind of images, no? In the op art scene I had to do a gig poster for MF Doom, which is also a hip-hop artist. And he's hidden behind this mask since 1997, so nobody has seen his face since a lot of years ago. So I thought that for the poster, I would do the same. I would hide himself behind an image. So it would be kind of metaphor of what he does to himself. So I started playing with this kind of lines, with this kind of op art images. And then finally I decided to replace all these little lines into these tubes that were getting one into each other. And finally the poster was like this. You see that the the lettering works exactly under the same rules of the image. And you can, if you see the poster near, it's very abstract, but the farther it gets, the more clearer it gets the mask, the image. So, getting back from what I was talking about, I left psychology and I went to study to Elizabeth. Some of the people of the book studied there, like them. And I think if you agree, this school is more focused on technology, or at least when we were there, it was like, this school has computer. A lot of universities at that time didn't have computers, so I have a connection with you, Rodrigo, now, because I am using freehand, which is also like on extinction, but this is what I learned there. But I think this program is very good for vectors because it's much more precise than Illustrator. The other things are not very good, but for vectors, freehand is very good. For example, I did this poster for Ray-Ban for the rare print campaign. 100%. This is 100% digital, done by freehand. But I didn't want to show you this because of that. I wanted to show you this because after doing the poster, they asked some guys to do a video clip, totally handmade, based on the poster. So you can see like an interpretation. It's by Spring Novelties and not more bright stuff. So I mainly work digitally, but in my free time, I enjoy a lot doing calligraphy. Why? Because of the process. The process is so hard that when you make an error, you have to, or you start again, or you have to think and do something that you can go forward with the thing you're doing. This is not happening when you do something digital. You can undo, it's easy, no? And I usually do this in monasteries where handphones are totally forbidden, no internet. You have to focus a lot on what you're doing. And this is another thing that contrasts with my daily work, which is mails, telephone, everything. And it's really hard to get focused on that. Well, I show you this because this is another thing you can say, but I don't use this for my commercial work because I'm not good at it, but in some way it helps me for my commercial work. So here you will see it very clear. I had a commission to do with Alex Trochut for Modern London to do some capital letters. So having done that before, this is much, much easier. To know how the knottings work, the flat images and everything. Also, I had a commission, this is how it looked at the end. Also, I had a commission of the Guardian to do the cover of the guide, which is a supplement, and it had to go to be about the Game of Thrones. And yeah, it had to have this middle-aged taste, so it kind of helps me. So, show us the process. Now I will show you directly how I do one thing. So it was a casualty, but I'm going to show the cover of the guide you have in your hands. It was for the Spain Arts and Culture Guide. So it was about the We Made This book. So we had to talk about Spanish creative scene. So I thought that it would be a good idea to talk about to make a very iconic image, which is a bulb. A bulb means an idea here and everywhere. And an exploding bulb could be like an explosion of ideas. So having the idea, the concept very clear, I could work the shape like much, much more abstract, in an abstract way. So I thought that I would work the bulb with little crystals. I have a shop under my studio of these gems and crystals, and I went there to see how the light was behaving, how the colors were behaving. So first of all, I show them a little sketch. This I do in Photoshop. And with this approved, I do a little sketch of the coloring. And then I made a little video so you can see how just one gem is done. It's really slow. It's like doing airbrushing. So I wanted to show you this because although technology allows us to go much faster, at the end, the process is really slow. because here you will see that there are tons. I think in this document there were 900 layers. So it's a really, really heavy document. And, hello, vale. You will see each one of the gems. So yeah, what I wanted to say is this, that technology makes things faster, but that doesn't mean that we have to do the things super fast, because they lose quality. No, we have to spend time, I think, on everything we do, and technology really helps us. But yeah, we need technology, but we need to go a little bit slow doing the things. And yeah, that's it. And I brought one poster of a silk screen. I'm just going to throw it away. Sorry. Sorry.
Wow.
Amazing, eh?
That was okay. Here we are. Thank you for coming. We are very happy to be here and to be next to
these great people,
amazing creative people. So, okay, we are starting in a few seconds. Yes, we're doing this. Are you having fun? Did you like the presentations? Yeah. Are you hungry? No. Okay. Me, I'm hungry. A little bit. Yeah, in Spain we eat very, very soon. Okay.
Well, I think it's the other way, but yeah.
No, yeah, okay. Okay, maybe we can start talking. We are Brosmine. We are a studio based in Barcelona, as Marta, and hello.
Yeah, we also start with hello. It's kind of,
yeah. Okay, so we are Brosmine. You can say we are very easy to draw, and this is our brand. And
we like to say that we are really optimistic people. That's why we have, if you go to our website, we have this little logo in animation on the top, because we are optimistic people.
Okay, so we mainly do illustration, advertising illustration, and also we are artists, but we do this kind of work. Here you can see some samples very fast, just to have that feeling.
So you have some input, just go to the website, because today we are not going to solve some, we are going to talk about the process, or just go to the website.
Okay, so just in case you didn't notice, we are brothers, and I'm the tall one.
But look at his hair, you know?
Yeah, totally I don't know what happened to me. When I grew up, yeah. Or my parents say that I'm that kid, but I'm not sure. Okay, so... I'm supposed to be that one.
And yeah, we love this picture one. Because we found it like 1 year ago. It looks like we're with the DeLorean, you know? It's like we're there in the middle of somewhere.
We love
like,
that picture. So we always have been a creative couple. So we like to say that we have more than 20 years of experience working together. So, and it's good because we have the same background. We grew up in the 80s. So in our opinion, it was the golden era or golden age of action figures. So we played with all those toys like G.I. Joe, Starcom, Marshall Brave Star, the Ninja Turtles, all of them.
I'm sure you play with them, right? Yeah, I'm sure you go now to the play stores, to the toy stores, there's nothing like that, right? It's like, what happened? It's like, oh, man.
Yeah, so as a creative couple, when we saw that, we also wanted to create our own toys or vehicles for toys. Here you have our version of the A-Team van.
Yeah, we were really lucky because at that time, our parents trust us like 100%. And they have these little workshops and they say, hey, kids, go there, no worry, use the saw, whatever. So we were building our own toys. We were like, man, I have the G.I. Joe action figure, but I can't buy the vehicle. Let's build our own vehicle. So we went to the workshop and we were trying to do new stuff, playing with boot like the A-Team band. We also play with the more technological stuff, like we did this solar remote control. It worked. It went really, really slow, but it worked. We also did like our own starships. And I'm sure that if you have G.I. Joes in your collection, I'm sure you found the screw and you open it and you start mixing all the collection. We totally broke the whole collection. We tried to build it back like, 10 years ago. And we lost both collections, like our own collection and the original collection. And now we are doing a bulk of our work and we're looking for it. And we only have four of them.
Yeah, but exactly. The one with the four arms is really cool. I prefer that to the original, no? Don't you think? Okay, let's go. We also read a lot of comics, Spanish and European comics, and also a lot of superhero comics from Marvel and DC. And we also create our own publishing company at the and we did this kind of books or comics.
No, we take some strips of paper, like A4, we just put those things like clack, 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 and you just have a book, you know, we were just filling them. And so we are putting here the best volume of them. We have like 100 of them, but
yeah,
it's like
just some of the covers, no? Like Rodrigo, this is a sorcery book.
Golden one,
this is Frankenstein. Here you can see some snapshot of the inside.
It's really dramatic. You see, like the action,
some action
like
scenes.
You know,
Rambo, Firewolf, Super Peloton.
It's like a super pedestrian, like the one you walk on the street. It's like.
And the special guest artist is Super Villano Man, and Super Max, Super Bot, and our favorite Iron Man. Yeah.
My brother did this book, you know, he was, I don't know, 8 years something, and he knew he has to write it in English, the whole thing, you know, he was already thinking in like a vision
global,
for the whole world,
yeah,
like global. And he, like, you know, Iron in Spanish is hierro with H, and he said, like, I'm going to write Iron Man. He put an H there, like, and for the Spanish people, he just in case, he put like El Hombre de Hierro, you know, it's like, hey.
I was trying.
He was like really international already, like.
I was trying to do my best. Okay. So, we also grew up with those amazing films.
So, yeah, we were like having our own toy company, our own comic book company. So, we were like, man, we love all those movies, you know, Back to the Future, Master of the Universe, Indiana Jones. Man, let's make our own production company, you know? Yeah, we have the chance to get this hand camcorder, like the classic.
Yeah, our father has this movie camera.
And he told us, like, oh, yeah, use it. You know, all our friends never could touch the camera, you know, and we were like, yeah, use it, whatever. So we built like Mingaro Films, you know.
Yeah, here you can see some snapshots. We did lots of movies this way, like Ghostbusters in the middle up there. We used this kind of special effects using the title feature of the camera.
We were using our own knowledge, you know, we knew how to draw, we knew how to build stuff. So we said, okay, we have all the knowledge to build our own movie company. And if you see like all the movies, there is only one person who usually understand, because the other one is with the camera, you know. Like then we got a tripod, then it was easier, so we were good and like, hey bro, what's up?
Yeah, okay. But what happened at the end? We grew up and we became adults. My mustache,
man, look at the hair of my brother. It's amazing,
it's amazing,
right? Look at him now, like, what happened, man?
Yeah, I don't know. It's the humidity in New York.
Yeah, it's all about New York, you know.
In
it's
Spain, like, I'm like that. No, okay.
Real Latino, you know. It's like, whoa.
So what happened when we grew up? We wanted to find a way to convert our hobby into our way of work. Or
exactly, you know, we study. He's a pharmacist. Yeah. I'm a product designer. Then he studied graphic design. So we were like working each of my other sides, and then we realized, man, I'm tired of working for the people. Let's try to make something like we did when we were kids, but let's try to get money. You know, let's make our hobby into our
into our
life.
That's why we create Brosmain Studio.
So this is our base, is our headquarters in Barcelona. So we like to say that our studio is like a playground kids, like it's like a room when we were kids. As brothers, we share a room like nearly all our life. So this is like a real room now.
Yeah,
you know,
and we work
the stuff we like.
There alone. There are only the two of us there in the studio, so we can do this kind of mess there. So very comfortable.
It's really funny because someone came to the studio, like really serious people, you know. We don't really get a lot of clients to the office, but when they came, they are like just looking to the walls. And I was like, hey, man, I'm here.
So what we do is
we do mainly illustration for advertising companies, mainly from the States, for the States. And we also have this more personal artistic side of work that is more like we try to do sculptures and other more artistic, because like illustration is like or the thing that we do real quick, and it's like, hey, one illustration, give me money, pa pa pa. But then, you know, we try to combine them, like, okay, I do this artistic stuff.
Yeah, and then we spend all the money in those kind of things, the things on the right. But those are like personal projects for the moment. Maybe in the future we'll be only artists. Okay, we are going to quickly explain how is the process?
Yeah. I mean, I'm not really, if you are a designer of creative people, usually when you go to school, they told you, you need a sketchbook, you know? So we were really like, man, we need a sketchbook. Then we realized you don't really need to have a really nice sketchbook. So you can do like really, this is the best page of all of them. And we have a lot of them. And look at that, whoa, man. So what we have is like, each of us has a sketchbook. And when we have a briefing or this idea that we want to develop, we just go sketching ideas, pa, 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 and then we sit down, next picture.
like really seriously, like, hey, bro, you know, I have this idea. What do you think?
Photograph was taken by surprise. We didn't know that.
Again, you know, we're using the tripod when we were kids, you know? It's like, there's no one else in the room. Special effects, you know? So yeah. Those are the tools we use right now. Like, we like to do everything by hand. We are still doing traditional illustration. We do pencil, then we do the ink, and then now we do colors. Like, as Marta said, like, we use technology to make stuff faster somehow.
Yeah, and probably you are wondering who of us is the one who draws everything, but this is the response. We draw at the same time. No, well, maybe not that exaggerate as here, but we have the same style since we start working 5 years ago or 6 years ago. We developed the same style. One was better at one thing, the other at others, but finally we learned to properly do the things that the other did best.
Okay. So yeah, we
got it.
What?
So at the end, the idea is that we have the same style and we do the pencil together.
So yeah, there was a day that we got this, like the first illustration stuff, like the first client, like, because we never learned how to do illustration. So we sit down and say like, man, we need to find a style. So we start like sitting down, like, okay, I can do this, you can do this, let's mix it. So we developed this style, and this is really quick to show you how we work. If you go to if you see our illustration, they're always really busy. So we start like sketching really quick, both of us like pa, 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 pa. We go fill in all the spaces. The drawings were really rough in the previous one. Then we go like clean the line, pim, pim, pim.
Yeah, so but this is the most important part of the process for us. When we decide that the pencil is finished, the project is finished for us, and then it's just a matter of time, of hours of work, because then when we arrive to this point, I do the ink work with using pens and different kind of brushes in the light box there. It's so big that I have to wear that stupid hat there sometimes.
Yeah, you know, he wears sunglasses.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we were there like, we have no idea which light box to get, you know, because, oh, I think we need a light box. Because previously we were doing like the ink and pencil on the same paper. So when you scan it, then it's all dirt, you know. We didn't even use the blue pencils. So the scanning was really there. So I was cleaning all that with the mouse, you know. We didn't even have a Wacom or anything. So then we realized, let's buy a light box and let's use two papers, you know, it's it.
Yeah, so.
So we say, okay, let's
Alejandro, yeah, when I finish the original artwork, he scans it, and with Photoshop, he adds the color. It's the only part of our work that it's made in digital.
Yeah, okay. Because we were like having all those issues, like we were really slow working like in post-production. So we say, okay, let's buy this screen, this Wacom. And it's great, but at the same time, it's bad because you just zoom like 500, you know, like you start like cleaning all the lines like in a point that it doesn't really matter. So it's that point like, okay, we want to keep the line, the hand-draw line, because we like how the flow goes and everything. But then we use the technology to make and improve the final
and
piece.
Also, yes, one note, everything we do is at the end is a bitmap. We never do vector graphics. We are not against vector, but just for your information. Okay. Okay, so this seems very funny. It seems that we have a lot of fun in the studio, but it's a really hard process.
You know, people when they see our studio and everything, you know, we have video games, blah, 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 they say, oh man, you must have fun, you know, all this color stuff you do is super fun, all these clients, whoa, man, but this is the truth, you know. We don't sleep, we have to work hard, you know, all these handmaids, like a pain in the ass at the end, you know, you have to. And then our mother is always like calling, man, stop working, go home, you don't have a life. It's like.
And okay, and. We have a really big we have these close arguments. You are very critical to the other because you are saying the truth. And I think that's very important for the world. We have to bring the world to sorry.
Oh, man. Ooh.
Maybe next time. Yeah. I'm the older. Okay, continue.
We are like the both of us at the studio. We always think like we need someone else to help us, man. No, say no. So we always say like we need someone else to help us, like even like in more the paperwork and stuff. But like having this relationship of his brother, all the same background, everything goes really easy. And all those fights that we think it's really necessary for our work, so we can like reach a higher level. because I can erase whatever he does, you know, he, mine and his brother, you know, it's like, yeah. Hey.
No, and we have those big arguments, but we are friends again after 5 minutes, so it's only a
if
family
If we have to work
argument.
With someone else, yeah. sometimes it's really hard because you cannot be that clear if you are not really close to him, you know. So if I tell him, man, that's blah, 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 then he's going to be, okay, but then he's going to go home and say like, man, this I'm not going to work with him again. So that's the cool thing about working with a brother. No?
Yeah. We strongly recommend it to you. Okay, so this is our momento. This sentence explains really well how we think and how is the philosophy of Brosman at work. Each project, each new project for us is the